the current economic framework, which was predicated on the belief that lowering taxes, liberalization, financial market liberalization, trade liberalization would lead to faster economic growth and to everybody's well-being increasing. We've now realized that those ideas were wrong. I'm Joe Stiglitz. I teach at Columbia University. The world today is facing a confluence of several problems, many of which are interrelated, that represent some real challenges that so far our political system has not been able to address effectively. We've had slower economic growth, less stable economic growth, as evidenced by the 2008-2009 crisis. Because the fruits of what limited economic growth were not widely shared, large fractions of the population have seen their income stagnate or even decline. This inevitably is not going to be socially or politically sustainable. We see that in the growing inequality, the problems of climate change, the worry about whether we will be able to create enough jobs with robotization. These problems, the failure to address these problems, is having serious consequences. One of the fundamental fallacies was a notion called trickle-down economics, which was never really part of standard economic theory, but became a key idea of economic policy formation in advanced countries and many developing countries. And that was that if you could only grow the economy, everybody will benefit. And we know that that is not true. There were, you might say, corollaries of this. A notion that globalization would itself lead to the growth of economies and everybody would be better off. Well, economic theory actually was much more qualified in its endorsement of free trade. For instance, I showed many, many years ago that if risk markets were imperfect, and they are, that trade liberalization could and would increase risk. The consequence of that was that everybody in all the countries could be worse off. What that says is before you liberalize, you ought to think about making sure your markets are working well. Another example, well known before our recent experience, but yet not talked about by policymakers, was the fact that job destruction could occur faster than job creation. And that would be particularly true if capital markets didn't work well, and they never are perfect. That said, there was an important role for government to both facilitate job creation and helping people move from the jobs that were being destroyed to the new jobs that were being created. Interestingly, particularly in countries like the United States, those who were pushing for liberalization, say in the Republican Party, at the same time opposed assistance that would have helped people make the adjustment. And in the absence of that, actually, again, everybody could be worse off or growth could be hindered. Much of what the criticism is that what was known was not emphasized. So for instance, one of the most important contributions in our understanding of trade were a series of theorems by Paul Samuelson and some of his associates, which showed that in advanced countries, liberalization, trade liberalization, would lower the incomes of unskilled workers. No one, when they were pushing for trade liberalization, even mentioned this. That was arcane theory. They didn't explain what was wrong with the theory. And in fact, as it turned out, that that theory had more than a little grain of truth. And then there are a whole set of other fallacies of that were, again, not based on what I would say modern economic science, but but widely held, partly because people were using simplistic models. Another example is that markets are efficient. Again, one of my contributions to economics with my colleague Bruce Greenwald was to show that whenever information was imperfect, asymmetric, or risk markets were incomplete, that is always, markets are not in general efficient. We've known that markets are neither efficient nor stable, and yet policymakers and many economists have proceeded as if, quote, economics taught us that markets were always efficient and stable. I wrote a book called Globalization and Discontents based on what I had seen as chief economist of the World Bank, suggesting that the discontent that one saw with globalization in the developing countries and emerging markets was in fact justified. Now we hear from Trump and protectionists in America that globalization was unfair to the United States. How can globalization be bad for developing and emerging countries, be bad for the United States? How can there be discontent in the developing countries and discontent in the United States? I mean, if everybody's against it, why is it proceeding as it is? Well, there's a very easy answer. It was a corporate agenda. It was an agenda that had the effect of lowering wages in the United States. It did help move many people out of poverty in the developing countries, but it was an agenda driven mainly by the desire to increase profits. You see that vividly in, for instance, the intellectual property agenda, the IPR agenda, which has increased the profits of big pharma at the expense of access to life-saving medicines all over the world. One of the reasons that globalization has not worked as well as it should have worked is that the rules governing globalization have been written to benefit the corporate interest. We need to rewrite the rules of globalization, for instance, of global trade, in ways that can work for the advantage of citizens. One approach to the discontents to globalization is an idea that's been put forward, which is called globalization with compensation, or globalization with some social protection. That's clearly necessary. We didn't provide the social protection that we should have provided. But I think politically that's no longer credible. People don't really feel confident that that will be, no matter what we say, it will actually be provided. We have a democratic system where when the Republicans get in power, they cut back those kinds of social protections that have been put forward. If we're going to really have sustained economic growth based on globalization, a welcoming of technical change that can threaten jobs, we have to have a deeper reform in our economic system, a new social contract that ensures that growth is inclusive, that there is shared prosperity. So it has to be much more fundamentally wired into the way our economic system works.